Good evening. Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts.
Tonight, investigators are trying to solve a bizarre mystery in Flagler County.
A number of people say they felt the ground shake today.
Oh, Welcome to the Midnight Hour. I'm your host, Brandyn Chaos, and I'm sitting here with Miss Tori. What's going on?
Not a whole lot. How's it going?
So, everybody right now is talking about the Grammys.
Oh, boy.
What's your take on Kanye once again bum-rushing the stage for a beautiful blonde-haired, blue-eyed singer?
Blonde-haired, blue-eyed? I thought it was Beyonce again.
Well, no, Beyonce is the reason he bum-rushed the stage, but it was while a blonde-haired, blue-eyed musician was up there.
Ah, again?
Yes.
Oh, really? See, this tells you how much I keep up on these kind of things.
So, yeah, Beck wins an award for Album of the Year for his latest album, which, who the hell even knew that Beck was still making music?
Not me.
So, Beck wins the award for Album of the Year, and Kanye comes running up and then is about to get on stage and say something and then just walks away laughing.
I don't know if he intended to say something or if it was a joke. I mean, I think if he actually stood up and said something, it'd probably be a completely different story. But
he was planning on saying something because as soon as he was doing like the post-Grammy talking BS, he said that Beck needs to respect true artistry and give his Grammy to Beyonce.
Okay, so then what's the point of going up on stage first off if you don't say anything and you just want to say it after? What, did he puss out? He's, like, what was the point?
He's a pussy. That's straight up what it was. And Beck even called him out. Beck, you know, saw him coming up, and I'm sure Beck knew who he was,
oh,
knew why he was coming up there.
Come on, everybody knows.
And he said, oh, apparently I need help. And as Kanye was walking away, he waves him over. He's like, hey, come back here.
Why do they keep letting Kanye pull this? Like, why do they have specific security sitting around Kanye so that he doesn't pull this crap?
Why do they keep letting Kanye at award ceremonies?
I have no idea.
Yeah. It's a bunch of crap. I don't understand Kanye, and I actually tweeted Kanye and Beyonce last night because they just need to knock it off.
Did you get a response on that one?
No, I didn't. I'm still waiting. I really hope I get
sure
something back.
I'm sure they've got tons of them, so maybe they'll get to yours eventually.
Yeah, hopefully. But, yeah, it's a whole bunch of crap. And the Grammys are overrated anyways. The Grammys don't really respect true artistry.
Any award and, ceremony is crap.
Well, the problem with the Grammys is they're old. The Grammys are old. They cater to what's old. They don't cater to what's new and what's hip. I mean, look at who won this year. Beck, an older artist. Sam Smith, who's got like an old school sort of vibe.
Yeah,
to him,
exactly.
You know?
I mean, he might not, he's a newer artist, but I mean.
Yeah, he's got an old school vibe
exactly.
to him. Adele won a few years ago, swept the awards, and she's got an old school vibe.
Yes, she does.
They don't care about what's new and what's fresh. And if you ask me, the Grammys have got to go.
Well, then maybe that's why Kanye keeps vouching for Beyonce.
I don't know. I don't think it has anything to do with it. Beyonce is old and washed up anyways. She needs to stop making music.
That was my point.
Yeah. I don't know. But then you have Tenacious D winning Best Heavy Metal Performance.
That's ridiculous.
And they beat out Anthrax, Motorhead, Slipknot, who all had great songs that they were nominated for.
They're a gag band.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, they're a comedy band, and I mean, they're good at what they do, but I would never put them in a class with Anthrax or Slipknot.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. I mean, they make good music, but it's not serious. I mean, it started as a joke, and that's the point of it, whereas these other artists, that's serious, that's their work, that's what they put into it, you know? I don't know. I just feel like that's not okay.
And the people that are defending Tenacious D winning that award are saying, well, it's a cover of a Dio song. So what? Just because it's a metal song that they were doing doesn't make them metal.
No, not at all.
No. So we've got a great show for you today. We've got Vinnie Dombroski going to be on the phone. He is the lead singer of Sponge and Crud. Spies for Darwin. He was in the band Loud House. He's been there, done that, seen it all. So we're going to have Vinny on the show here in a little bit. And don't forget, next Saturday, which is February 21st, down at Chippers in Austintown, which is down in the Youngstown area for all our Youngstown listeners. Resonaut, Star, Baroque, Monody, and Letters will be playing a free show. It starts at 9 p.m. It's going to be a great time. Of course, if you remember, Rick Polo from Baroque Monody was on the show a while back.
Yeah,
2 months now, geez.
Something like that, yeah.
And then Joe Sinkovich, lead singer of Resonaut, was on the show the following week.
I'm pretty psyched for that show.
Yeah, so you get to see both those bands. They're awesome. And then, of course, Starve, they're from Erie, PA, going to be in town. I believe this is their first Youngstown show. I'm not 100% sure about that, but I believe it's their first Youngstown show, which is really cool. And then, of course, Letters is going to be there as well. But this weekend, it's a day that either you love or you hate. It's Valentine's Day. And here's something funny. Like, for years I've been seeing people jokingly posting on social media, like, hey, let's get rid of Valentine's Day and do second Halloween. And actually in the Cleveland area, this weekend, there will be a haunted house. So I'm kind of like, is this really going to be a thing?
Can
like,
we do this? Can we what? Make this happen? Because I'm okay with that.
Well, like, is this really becoming a thing that people are, you know, who are single every year for Valentine's Day are going to do this whole second Halloween thing?
Even if I were not single, I would most definitely go to that because, seriously, haunted house, awesome.
It's definitely an interesting concept doing a second Halloween there instead of Valentine's Day.
Well, I mean, I've even seen people around Christmas time. They just keep up their Halloween decorations. There are some people that are dedicated to that 365. So
yeah, those are called hillbillies.
No,
keep their Christmas lights up all year round.
Those are called goth kids.
But actually, I think I'm gonna be in Pittsburgh this weekend.
What?
Yeah, I'm gonna head to Pittsburgh for Valentine's Day. I'm going to head on down to the Smiling Moose over on the south side. Pittsburgh, I love Pittsburgh. It's, you know, Youngstown is my home. Pittsburgh has always been my second home. That's where I go. I got a lot of people there, a lot of friends, you know, people I like to hang out with. Tremendous music scene out there. They have a great burlesque scene too, which is really cool.
I was
cool.
Gonna say, what are you doing on Saturday?
As a matter of fact, I'm going to be checking out the Steel City Kitty showing some titties. Yes, that's
hopefully.
Right. We're gonna see the Steel City Kitties down there in the Bridge City.
Say that 10 times fast.
Yeah, Steel City Kitties are gonna be at the Smiling Moose in Pittsburgh, so I'm gonna be heading out for that. It's gonna be fantastic. I'm really excited about it. And I haven't plugged this on the show yet, so I'm going to go ahead and get this out of the way right now. On March 14th, I will be in Austintown, Ohio, which is, again, just outside of Youngstown for all my, Cleveland and Pittsburgh people. It's, in Austintown, it's, their St. Baldrick's Day festivities. I will be, for charity raising money and shaving my head for money for a charity for kids with cancer.
Shaving that big old cue ball.
We're going to be raising money for the St. Baldrick's Foundation, which is for they raise money for kids with cancer. So we're going to be doing that on March 14th. Come on down and watch me get my head shaved. In fact, Ryan Ross and the Y-Town Syndicate will be playing that event. So we had Ryan on the show, 2 weeks ago? Yeah, 2 weeks ago. We had Ryan Ross on the show. Great guy. Had a great conversation with him. Him and his band, well, he and his band, if you're a grammar Nazi, will be playing at St. Baldrick's Day at Austintown O'Donald's in Austintown, Ohio. I'm pretty sure that's going to be a fun time. Watch me get my head shaved. Listen to the Y-Town Syndicate.
Do it for charity.
And, yeah, give some money for charity. You can go to stbaldricks.org. If you type in my full real name, Brandyn, Brandyn Petrick, Petrick, you can find me that way and donate some money for kids with cancer. All right, without any further ado, we're going to get Vinnie Dombroski on the phone.
Some dream I made up, though I can't see.
All right, I've got Vinnie Dombroski on the phone. He is the lead singer of Sponge. How are you doing today, Vinnie?
Doing good, Brandon. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm not doing too bad. So you guys are on the road right now, right?
Well, we were out on the road November, December, and pretty much right up until Christmas. You know, we've done a handful of one-offs since then, but we're just kind of back in Detroit, regrouping, plotting, and scheming for the upcoming year.
Well, I know you guys are coming to Cleveland here pretty soon, right?
Yeah, absolutely. The Rock Bar, from what I recall. And I'm trying to figure out, we played the Rock Bar down in the Flats a few years back. Is it the same location? Is it a different location? Do you have any idea?
I'm not actually sure. I've never been there, so I don't know.
Got it.
But I know you guys really enjoy playing Cleveland.
We have a long history with Cleveland. Playing any venue that I can imagine being in Cleveland over the last 20 years, I think we played it. But Cleveland being a huge supporter of the music, even before Detroit was playing Plowed 20 years ago, Cleveland was playing Plowed. One of the first cities to really get it in rotation and really just getting people familiar with the band. So we had great audiences right from the get, just because of the enthusiasm at radio and from the fans.
Well, I know I remember you saying several years ago at a show in Cleveland that Cleveland's kind of where you guys got your start at.
Yeah, without a doubt. Radio, there was some issues with radio in Cleveland at the time. I think MMS and EMZ, perhaps, back in the day, were kind of like battling over who was going to play Sponge. And for a minute, we couldn't even play in town in Cleveland because of the issues going on at radio. But because of that, I'm certain that we created quite a following early on in Cleveland, way before many other cities started to kick in and play the music.
So let's talk a little bit about how the band got started. You guys were originally called Loud House, correct?
We had a band called Loud House with a different singer at the time. And when that band kind of fell apart post-Virgin Records, we did one record with those folks. The band kind of like dissolved, but we regrouped and started something new that was Sponge.
So how did Sponge get started then, as far as like in the wake of the breakup of Loud House?
Well, we just got back into the recording studio. We kept on writing. We thought, well, if we're going to do anything, we were just going to keep writing and making our own records. Essentially, years ago, even in the Loud House days, we were very proactive recording-wise, video-wise, and doing things on our own. It wasn't unfamiliar to us. We didn't need a record label to go record. We just did these things on our own. So the idea was to just continue working, writing songs, rehearsing, doing gigs. And lo and behold, it was, I think because of the group's efforts and hard work that we started to get some interest regarding some other labels and whatnot. But it was pretty much business as usual.
How did you make that move to vocalist?
I did a considerable amount of writing when it was Loud House. Participated in that, and I began to sing on the demos for the Sponge stuff, and it just worked.
That's really cool, man. So how did you guys end up landing the Sony deal?
We maintained management in between the bands. You know, there was still, we weren't certain what we were going to do, but we knew that we were going to write and record. And based on the quality of the stuff that we were doing, you know, the management thought, well, you know, guess what? Maybe you guys got a shot at something else. So we started taking meetings with different labels, and Sony seemed like a real good place for us. So that's where we went.
Definitely the thing that people probably most remember you guys for is the Wax Ecstatic album.
Okay.
Now, that album has an incredibly unique sound for that time period. There was a lot of Southern rock and blues and even some R&B mixed in there. And I have always said that it's probably the most Detroit-sounding record you'll ever hear. So what influenced a lot of the sounds on that record? Because it was such a change from what you guys were doing before and from everything else that was out there.
Just trying to think back, what we were going for back then was a real, I think, real embracing of what it was and the defining of what it was that brought Sponge together. You know, the band that we loved, the era of music that we were from, the 70s. And the 70s being Bowie and Iggy Pop and groups like that, I just go, the Mick Ronson style of guitar playing, that's kind of what we were going for. That was the essence of that vibe. And it was kind of, when I think back, I just go, it was kind of a real defining and embracing of our rock and roll roots. And we were just trying to bring that forward.
Do you have a favorite Sponge album?
Oh, man.
Yeah, I know. That's a tough question, isn't it?
Yeah. I thought that, you know, the Wax record was certainly a defining record for the group. I think of the first record, and I didn't realize this until we were out there doing the whole Rotting Pinata record live. We were out there playing that whole record. We did a tour on that record, and that's all we played. We did a live record, and just revisiting those songs, I go, man, there were some really good songs on that record. It made me kind of appreciate that record all over again. That was cool, but the second record was certainly, it was great to define what we were about and go for that. You know, the New Pop Sunday record, I thought, as far as crafting a record, you know, we worked really hard on that record. And that record went through many different hands and many changes. And just for the fact that we finally put it out, we put it out on a label that was not Sony Records. We went through a lot of changes business-wise at the time. And getting that record out, having done all the work, it was a super challenge, but it was a super gratifying experience to make the record. And as far as the craft of making a record, I was pretty proud of that record. But oddly enough, that was one of those records that just kind of disappeared. It came and it went. That was about it. You know, it's got us into the For All the Drugs in the World record, and that was a blast to make, and that really turned out fantastic. But most people don't know about the records that came after Wax or New Pop.
And it's unfortunate because those are all great records, really. You know, For All the Drugs in the World, The Man, Galore Galore, all great albums.
I mean, even up till, you know, 2014, 2013, when we put out Stop the Bleeding, we did have the Destroy the Boy EP, which some of those songs are on the, as a matter of fact, all of those songs are on the Stop the Bleeding record.
And I like how you changed up the style, like the way those songs are played on the new record. I like how you changed it up a bit, too.
Well, you know, we just take that liberty. And again, a lot of the bands that we listened to back in the day, it's just, you know, was Bowie always doing what Bowie did? You know, Iggy, everybody goes, well, Iggy and the Stooges, but the people know about Iggy's records, like, is it called Blah, Blah, Blah? I think it was called, man. You know, it's like those records that Iggy made in the 80s certainly don't sound like Iggy from the Stooges days. And you go through those transformations. We were just like, why can't we do that? You know, Zeppelin did things like that. So many bands did things like that. We didn't want to be pigeonholed to one particular sound.
Yeah, that's bad to be pigeonholed, really. Another thing is, after you guys put out Wax Ecstatic, you guys got the golden opportunity to open up for Kiss on their reunion tour.
Sure.
What was it like opening up for Kiss?
Well, I mean, it being the legendary Tiger Stadium in our hometown, where we sat and watched many baseball games, and so many of our fans were there, and people knew the songs. This was after the Rotting record. This was during the Wax Ecstatic tours. So everybody knew Plowed, everybody knew Molly. It's a real thrill to be out there with, you know, Kiss, but our pals and Alice in Chains. That was a real thrill, and people knowing the music. They're out there singing Plowed, and they're stone-cold Kiss fans, you know, in all the makeup, and they're out there singing Plowed. It was a pretty proud moment for us.
Yeah, that's going to be a really exhilarating moment to have thousands of Kiss fans singing your songs.
Oh, yeah. It's like one of those pinch-me moments, but pinch me moment is anytime I hear Plowed on the radio today. You know, I would have thought that 20 plus years later, that song is still banged on rock radio. It's like a staple of rock radio right now.
So it still gives you the same thrill to hear it on the radio now as it did 20 years ago?
Probably more so, yeah, because it's just like, songs come and go, but this one ain't going to go away anytime soon. Nope. You just didn't go, well, I think we wrote a good one.
What was going through your head when you realized that was a hit song?
Never, ever thought it was a hit song. I knew it was a good song. And based on the reaction that we got from it before it was a hit song, quote-unquote, it was a radio song, we just knew that the reaction we got live at the shows that something was going on with this tune, people would go, man, that's a great song. I'd be like, well, okay, because understand the climate of radio when we were coming out with that tune. Rock radio was something that was always around, and rock radio at that time was, you know, Guns N' Roses, Led Zeppelin, AC/DC. The modern rock format was becoming popular, which was your Chili Peppers and your Jane's Addiction and Pearl Jam, Alice in Chains. It wasn't really something up-tempo like that, but more so just those rock radio stations playing Zeppelin and AC/DC. That was what people would call a hit. Then Bob didn't sound anything like a hit, and quite frankly, we weren't sitting there going, well, we're going to write a hit song. I'm sure people can do that, but that wasn't going through our heads at the time.
Now, here's another great question, something I've been wondering since the song came out. What exactly is Wax Ecstatic?
Well, it turned into this drug that we would sell, like a happy pill, and something that would solve all your troubles. That was Wax Ecstatic. It was a product.
So was it a real product before you guys wrote the song?
No. I mean, that was kind of the idea of the video too. We were out there selling this pill out of a bottle called Wax Ecstatic.
Now you guys have gone through some lineup changes with the band. Do you get a lot of disrespect from older fans that, you know, are mad that you're still touring under the Sponge name?
I mean, I guess early on there might have been a couple people that were just not pleased. But like most bands, what's important is the music and the music living on. And the changes that were made in a way, I believe that the music is represented well. And the fellows that had been in the band, Kyle and Andy, have been with the group now, man, over 12 years. That was much longer than the original guys, you know. Billy, our drummer's been with us, oof, man, it's going on probably 13, 14 years, you know. So with that said, that much of the lineup has been extremely stable. Certainly not the original guys, but we've had a real solid, stable lineup, and a lineup that represents the music really well. I'm happy and proud to say Tim Padlin plays bass with us. He's produced a number of our records, Stop the Bleeding being the most recent, the earliest one. Tim was right there co-producing and engineering with the band. That's Rodney Pinata record, the very first one. So he's been part of the family since the absolute beginning. So we're pretty lucky to have a solid lineup currently.
And I also noticed you guys have had three bass players all named Tim. Was that planned?
Is that coincidence or what?
Was that planned?
No, I mean, it's not like we, you know, put an ad in the paper and said, calling all bass players with the name of Tim. We did not do that, but it's a complete coincidence.
Do you still keep in touch with any of the early bandmates?
Joey and I talk from time to time. I've talked to Mike several times, because there's this old business issues that crop up from time to time, especially when you've been making music as long as we have, publishing issues, license issues, things of that nature. So it's inevitable that we would have to sit down, and I'm glad we could do it and not have to go through lawyers and crap like that, because it would just be a pain in the ass and would cost people money. So I'd much rather sit down at a table with somebody than talk to the lawyer.
So you guys are all still friendly then?
Absolutely, yeah.
Now, you've had a few side projects in your career as well. Crud, of course, a lot of people know about. And, of course, one that a lot of people really don't know about is Spies for Darwin. How exactly did that project get together?
I think our management at the time was Susan Silver. Silver Management. And Susan represented Soundgarden and Alice in Chains and, of course, Sponge. And at the time, that project was happening. There wasn't much going on with Alice in Chains. The band was just kind of on a hiatus. Of course, the stuff that had gone on with Wayne, and you'd really sit and go, well, where can a band like that turn at that point in time? So, fellas still wanted to make music. DeGarmo was not active with Queensryche anymore, and all those fellas are friends, and they were just interested in making music. They had sent me some demos of what they were doing, and I said, well, I'll take a crack at it. So I just recorded some stuff, vocals on the stuff at home, and sent it back, and it's kind of how we started. And I made several trips out to Seattle to work on songs and record out there, and made that fine EP. Certainly I'd like to make another record or finish that record, make it an EP at some point along the way, but it's just always certainly a matter of time. And I know the Alice guys, Sean and Mike, have been super busy. Nagamo, he's a busy man as well. So it's always good to see him. The last Sponge tour that we did on the West Coast in December, we got a chance to sit down and have a beer, and it was good to see those fellas.
So you've had the chance to tour with a lot of great bands. What were some of your favorite bands to tour with?
Wow. I mean, the tour that we did, the World Tour, was a real blast. Seven Dust. That was like when Seven Dust was first coming out. Great bunch of guys. Reverend Horton Heat was on the tour. Iggy Pop was on the tour. Bloodhound Gang. A lot of fun. Just a lot of fun with those bands. All good guys. Real blast. And of course, doing Lollapalooza in 96. Sharing the stage with the Melvins. That was always a blast. Like, 3 months of, we would watch the Melvins play and Sponge would play.
Wasn't Metallica on Lollapalooza that year?
Yeah, the Cows would play before the Melvins. I mean, just a kick-ass group of bands, and of course the main stage with the rotating casts of bands. Of course, Soundgarden and Metallica were the mainstays, and they would have like Rage Against the Machine play some dates, Devo come and play some dates, Ramones, fantastic changing cast of characters with that, but. Yeah, we've done so many great things. Of course, the Summerland Tour was a real blast. A lot of great bands, great fellas, Everclear, Filter, the guys in Live were just super guys. And we toured with Live like in the beginning, man, back in 94. So it was good to see those guys again. But we've just done a ton of stuff, and so many different gigs with so many different bands. The Cramps, Deftones, it's just insane. Ministry, we play with those guys. Been such a great cast of different bands, man. It's mind-boggling, really, but certainly those groups come to mind.
I can only imagine some of the stories you would have from the road with some of those bands. Just an eclectic array of bands you've toured with.
Oh, and just great folks. Just great groups and great music moments. Just sitting, watch some of these bands play and their favorite bands of yours, not from just a musical point of view, but from a fan point of view. You just go, man, this is jaw-dropping. Just sit there and go, wow, here we are, sharing the stage, man. This is just too deep.
Now, I'm just curious here. You've been around for a while. It's been 21 years since Rotting Pinata came out. What's your feelings on the current state of popular music and rock music?
Well, I certainly think that rock music is alive, but it's a young man's game. The idea of guitar, because I think, just hearing about the Grammys, I think that won Best Rock Album or something like this, and I could go, well, God bless you, but I just think, I don't even think rock was represented much at all in the Grammys. Not like it is the barometer for rock music, but I think it's definitely a young man's game these days. With the Black Veil Brides and the Stripes, I just go, well, there's still a pulse out there. But as far as guitar goes, it seems like guitar has been replaced with other instruments, and it's not really a guitar thing anymore.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that, because even like the new 6AM album has a lot of electronics in it, which was kind of disappointing for me.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it was kind of nice to see Beck winning a bunch of awards, but I don't really consider him to be a representative of rock music,
Well, yeah, I mean, I think popular music these days is certainly defined as being a young man's game. Country music is a little more forgiving, although there's a lot of young country artists. What's the group, man? Something Sons. I'm trying to think of the name of the group, man. They're like,
Mumford and Sons?
No, man. No. I'll think of it in a couple of minutes. But they're doing a real good job at representing rock music, but they're not young. Anything that I've heard about regarding rock music lately, just talking to club owners and younger fans of music, they're really drawn from, it's like hair metal bands and Motley Crue style stuff, and they're digging back into stuff that you would consider like, well, they're digging into Zeppelin, Deep Purple, Hendrix. They're really digging deep to learn about guitar and learn about those bands, and there's a real passion for it, you know. But again, these aren't like, you know, 30-year-old guys. These are kids that, you know, 15, 16, 17 that are really learning how to do the shit the way it used to be done. And there you have the enthusiasm, and there you will see where rock is starting to blossom again. I go, there certainly still is tons of hope.
So do you think that real soon we'll see rock come back into the mainstream?
I don't know. I think if young people are doing it and young people are buying the records, then at that point it'll be represented correctly. And I think that popular culture will begin to, you know, open up its arms again to it. But, you know, with all the other mediums of delivering music, via programming and sense and whatnot, that seems to be something that interests a lot of people regarding the production of rock music these days.
You see a lot of younger people at your shows?
We see all kinds of people at our shows, but it's interesting, the kind of bands that I'm seeing come to open up for us, that's interesting. And the kind of music that they're playing, you know, it's like real young people, but they're playing rock, you know. And I'm not even talking like alternative rock. They're playing like rock music that's rooted in the 70s, not West Coast hair metal rock either. It's kind of like this bluesy kind of style of rock. And again, they're learning how to play the music, and the singers present themselves in a way that is representative of like what was going on in the early 70s with rock music.
Now, I've seen you guys in Cleveland several times at Peabody's. You guys played there quite a bit. And just about every time I saw you guys there, you had a gang of local openers. Is that something you guys plan, or is that something the venue puts together?
That was something that the venue put together. What they were doing at Peabody's with the, you know, multiple rooms, it's almost like they turned it into a one-day festival, you know what I mean? And it would start early, and they'd have all these bands playing. And we've done it. We've rolled into Cleveland and played different ways many times. But when we would come to Peabody's, that's how they would roll. Again, it was like a festival thing.
Is that something you enjoyed doing? Because I know I saw you out in the crowd checking out some of these young bands.
Oh, man, it's always great to go out and look at a band, you know, as long as I can sit there and watch them and not start talking to somebody. You know what I mean? It's like that's a challenge, man. If I go peek my head out, you know, I go, I'm out here because I'm interested. I hear something, I'm digging. And I like to talk to people, but when I'm watching a band, I just go, I hate to disrespect the band running my mouth or they're playing. So.
Yeah. Now, back in like the fall of 98, when Limp Bizkit released the single Faith and Korn released their single Got the Life, and nu metal kind of became the mainstream, alternative kind of died like right there on the spot, what were you thinking at that point?
Well, we could feel it, man. The writing was on the wall at that point. And that's why it's like bands like Soundgarden, the Smashing Pumpkins, those just giant bands just kind of went away. And you could tell it in the radio programming at the time. And what was going on with radio was a lot of radio was beginning to be programmed by consultant companies and not just the stations anymore. They were more concerned about marketing, selling ads, playing the exact right music, making it a science, looking at a demographic, and trying to appeal to that audience in order to just get the numbers up at these stations. So at that point, it was really kind of difficult for Sponge to kind of fit into that, and any new music to be presented to radio at that time. It's like you could feel it in the air. It just, everything went cold. And Soundgarden took a long break. Pumpkins took a long break. Alice in Chains wasn't active anymore. And a lot of the bands from that era just kind of like stepped aside for a while this new kind of rock was doing its thing. And that prevailed. I mean, that was a big chunk of radio. And that style of music and those bands that came out of that particular time dominated radio.
And what are your thoughts on some of those bands? Do you get into some of that?
Oh, I mean, I I believe what they do, man. I believe what they do. Like, I listen to it and I go, that's very believable. You know, it's not necessarily my thing, but I can respect it from the point of view, like, they're carrying the torch for rock, you know? Would I play music like Slipknot? No, I think Slipknot is a kick-ass band, though. I'm like a fan of Slipknot. I would go, people would say rock is dead. I'd go, well, just look at Slipknot. Some people may argue with me on that, but I just go all the way back to Alice Cooper. And if you look at the movie Supermensch, the movie about Shep Gordon, and you look what Cooper was doing back then, I just go, well, that was rock and roll. Why isn't Slipknot rock and roll? Look at what Slipknot does. I just think they image themselves fantastic. They write great songs. The presentation live is just fantastic. So why is that not rock and roll? So it's not something I would create, but I can understand why it's great and why people dig it.
Now, nowadays, where do you draw your influence from for your music?
Well, it's like the rock thing. I mean, even thinking about doing a new Sponge record, I wouldn't even know where to begin, to tell you honest to God's truth. And I'd have to have an idea about what I would want to do. And these days, man, you know, I got the Orbitsons, the group that I've been doing for many years, probably 15 years now. And I feel like, you know, my energies are put towards that, writing in that style, and having written a ton of songs lately for that. I mean, I can get my head wrapped around it. But as far as rock goes, and where I fit in rock music these days, until I got, like, a, you know, like, something to say musically in that way, in that Sponge direction, I don't know where I would go with it, because we weren't even sure we were going to make another full-length record when Stop the Bleeding came out. We finished that record, and that kind of represented where we were at that time, but to go, well, where are we going to be in 2015, 2016 regarding making a rock record? I don't even know. Really, I don't know. And so to where I would draw the inspiration from, I don't even have the place to draw the inspiration from at the moment.
Now, something I've been wondering for many years about, you know, veteran musicians like Sponge, when you guys put out a new record and you guys go on tour in support of the new album, how hard is it for you to cut out some of the older songs to make room for the new songs? Is that a tough job to do?
We're one of those bands we have no problem playing to hit. Now, well, Radiohead won't play Creep anymore, from what we understand. So, like, we have no problem playing a song like Plowed. We just continue to play Plowed, and we're happy to see people happy about us playing Plowed. Molly, Wax Ecstatic, Mary, Rain in My House, those are staples in our show, man. We definitely do that. But it's fun to play stuff that we haven't played in a while, you know, stuff like 28 Days off of For All the Drugs in the World, and we'll play Treat Me Wrong from that record, or we'll jump back and play Silences or Drug, or we're playing 1,000 Times from New Pop Sunday, or we're playing Faith from View from the new record, or we're taking a stab at Dance Floor from the new record. I mean, we're not just playing a 60-minute show typically, you know, it's like 75 minutes plus, and, you know, we're kicking around all kinds of things, and we're taking chances with it, too. Even some stuff that people would go, can you play Nina Menasha? We don't typically play that in the set. We'll play it, you know. We'll play Miles if they ask for it. So it's always like, we never write a set list, and we're always taking feedback from the audience, so we're doing our best to kind of just mix it up anyway. So, yeah, we know that there's certain songs that will always be in the set. However, we're always dumping new stuff in.
Yeah, and I always liked how you guys take requests at the shows. Not a whole lot of bands will do that. They just stick with the set list. That's really awesome that you guys do that.
We haven't done a set list in many years. We don't even make set lists.
Do you guys still play Planet Girls?
Yeah, on occasion we do. If somebody wants to hear it, man, we'll play it. Yeah, we certainly play it, man. We'll do that. We'll, you know, Party Till We Drop. It just depends on what people want to hear, you know?
All right, Vinny, well, I'm going to have to get going, man. It was great talking to you. I really appreciate you coming on the show, man.
Well, it was good to talk to you, Brandon. Great job. Great talking to you. I look forward to talking to you again sometime.
And you guys are coming to Cleveland in April, right?
We will be out there in March.
March, okay.
I believe it's that first Friday in March.
Okay, March 6th.
I believe that's the one.
Awesome, man. I look forward to seeing you guys. I will be at that show for sure.
Likewise, man. Come on, say hello.
All right, definitely, man. Thank you for coming on the show.
All right, brother. Take care.
Bye. Take my lips and show them shut without words. I try and blow away. She said that we were both so out of touch. And when we talk, we say things that don't mean anything. I hear your voice, but you're so far away. Without you, without you, help. All right, there was Vinnie Dombroski from Sponge. Great talking to Vinnie, and I definitely look forward to the show on March 6th. I don't know why I was thinking it was in April, but it's in March. On March 6th at the Rock Bar in Cleveland. So that's going to be a good time. I will be there. So if you're going to be at the Sponge show, come on out and say hi. And yeah, we're going to, as Sponge would say, party till we drop. And I've been filling your ears with some great Sponge songs today. Opening up the show, you heard, of course, one of their biggest hits, Wax Ecstatic. And then going into the interview, that was their absolute biggest hit, Plowed, their first hit single from 1994, if you can believe that. It was 21 years ago off of the Rotting Pinata album. So if you're a fan of Sponge and you're not really hip to the newer stuff, if you really aren't aware of the stuff that came after Wax Ecstatic, they put out some tremendously great records. They weren't real successful, but they were good records nonetheless. Their third album, New Pop Sunday, is it's a different sounding record, just as Wax Ecstatic was. New Pop Sunday was a bit of a power pop, glam pop sort of sound. It was really good. I like it. I just played a track off of that album, Live Here Without You, which was the one and only single off of that album. And then in 2003, after 4 years away, the band put out For All the Drugs in the World. And then 2005, they put out The Man. I think it was either 2007 or 2008, they put out Galore Galore, which is another great record. And then 2013, they put out Stop the Bleeding, their latest album. And the Destroy the Boy EP was before that in 2010. So the band's still pumping out great music. If you're a fan of that Detroit sound, it doesn't matter what kind of sound it is. They bring in influence anywhere from Iggy and the Stooges and the MC5 to just some great Motown-sounding stuff. There's a song on Galore Galore called I Did It Without the Drugs, and just a beautiful Motown-sounding song. You know, Sponge is probably the most Detroit-sounding band that you'll ever hear. They're just phenomenal. And so March 6th at the Rock Bar in Cleveland, make sure you guys come on out and say hi to me. I'll be hanging out with the band. It'll be a good time for sure. And if you're in the Youngstown area this weekend, if you're looking for something to do, make sure you head on out to Cedars West End on Friday night at 11 p.m. for Enchantment Under the Sea, a 50s prom and burlesque show featuring music by the Spastic Hearts. Also, hosting the whole thing will be drag queen Aaron Starr, and they're bringing a few burlesque dancers there too, which will be pretty cool. You know, we tried the whole live bands and drag burlesque sort of thing at Macabfest last year, and hopefully we'll have that element back this year. But make sure you go check it out on Friday the 13th at Cedars West End in Youngstown. That promises to be a good time. Of course, if that's not really your thing, or if you want to do something before that, maybe pregame it, head out to Warren, the Lime Tree Sandwich Gallery, which will be where we're having the inside stage for Macabfest. Mark Sweeney is going to be performing live there. I think he does like acoustic sort of stuff, but this Friday at the Lime Tree, yeah, he'll be there 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. So you can head out to that and then head on out to Youngstown. Go hit up Cedars West End and see the Spastic Hearts and a phenomenal burlesque show. So a lot of good stuff going on this weekend. Saturday, if you're looking for something to do, you could head on out to Austintown O'Donald's, where I used to be a resident DJ, and a place that I really like to hang out. They're just great people. It's a great atmosphere. DJ Steve Fish is there on Saturday nights, and Simply Ed is there on Friday nights. But this Friday and Saturday, Austintown O'Donald's is doing their 50 Shades of Beer. You show them your movie ticket stub from 50 Shades of Grey, and you'll get a free appetizer and $3 pints all night. Plus, bartender Jason Cuttrell will have a new drink called the Red Room. And in his words, don't ask what is behind the door, just enjoy. So a lot of great stuff going on this weekend in Youngstown. And once again, I just really want to plug the Supporting Your Local Music show at at Chipper's on Saturday, February 21st, starts at 9 p.m. Headlining that night will be Resonaut. If you remember, we had Joe Bob Sinkovich on the show a few months ago. Great guy. The whole organization is great. Joe, Billy, and Chris Young, they put on some great shows. So stop on out for that. I will be there as well. They will also have Starve from Erie, PA. I'm not too familiar with them, but from what I hear, they're fantastic. Local favorites, Baroque Monody, will be there. They are one of our trio of headliners for the Macabre Fest Festival this year. They played last year, too. They're a great, great band, some of the nicest people you will ever meet. Also, Letters will be there, so it's going to be a good time. Definitely looking forward to that one. If you are... if you're Irish or just a heavy drinker, you're already planning out your St. Patrick's Day festivities, make sure that Saturday, March 14th, one of your stops will be at Chipper's in Austintown. Once again, it's a great bar, great place to hang out, cheap drinks, and a wonderful staff. And that night, they will have a fantastic show with five bands, Seven Stone, Rule of Two, A Damn Shame, Zero Set Memory. If you remember, Dean from Zero Set Memory was on just a few weeks ago. And also, After the Invasion will be there as well. So, I'm not sure if I'll be at that show or not. But even if I'm not there, still stop out. I will be at the St. Baldrick's Day event at Austintown O'Donnell's, getting my head shaved for charity that day. So, if I have time afterwards... you know, maybe I'll stop out for that show. I might get there a little late. Either way, it's going to be a great time. So if you want to go out for that, go ahead. And then, like I said, I'll be at the St. Baldrick's Day thing at Austintown O'Donnell's. And Ryan Ross and the Y-Town Syndicate will be playing that. So that'll be a good time as well. And we will be getting plastered for charity. And as always, don't forget to check us out on social media. On Facebook, it's Brandyn Chaos, Chaos Culture Entertainment, Macabre Fest, and The Midnight Hour with Brandyn Chaos. So go ahead and like those pages on Facebook. Also, you can find me on Twitter and Instagram. It's at Brandyn_Chaos. And don't forget, Brandyn is spelled B-R-A-N-D-Y-N. So, another week down. I don't have anything planned for next week, so next week's show right now is a surprise. Working on a few things. We're going to see how things pan out. There will be a show next week, I guarantee you of that, but I just don't have anything planned out, so let's just make this one a surprise. Whoever we have next week will definitely be a surprise for you, surprise for me. And this week, we're gonna play you out with some more Sponge. It's Destroy the Boy, which was the title track of the Destroy the Boy EP, re-recorded with a lot of change-ups in the song for the Stop the Bleeding album. So this is the version from the Stop the Bleeding album. So we're going to play you out with some Sponge with Destroy the Boy. And as always, I am Brandyn Chaos, and you were listening to The Midnight Hour.